What a beautiful sunny day in the city of Tacoma, the evergreen state of Washington. What a wonderful day to go swimming, take a walk in the park. Whatever you want to do, you can enjoy the splendor of God's creation. Now we would like to take a trip back in the past to Camp Moran on Orcas Island, where Flora Nobles was a volunteer working at Operation Long Thrust, a youth camp. Here is a portion of her life story. There she is in the red and black. Look at her athletic skills. Now we go to the basketball court where Flora Nobles. The joys and pleasures of life. Showed a little bit of defense. This one's over!
Of the distractions, especially in sprints, if you're just the slightest turn of the head could make you lose the race. Y'all saw how she ran up here. If she keeps these things off, she's not going to be able to run the race.
Been a very active person, even as well in high school. I was an athlete. I played volleyball, basketball, I ran track, and even throughout my adult life, I was still very active. I could do whatever I wanted, whenever I wanted, and it didn't really faze me. I still exercised, I still did water aerobics, and pretty much whatever I wanted to do. And then I was diagnosed with uterine cancer. I had a hysterectomy, and after that I had radiation. And after the radiation, I felt like my energy just wasn't coming back. But I thought it was due to the radiation. So several months after the radiation, I was still sick, and I wasn't gaining my strength back. I was sick, I was getting weaker, and had been going to the doctor, and they couldn't figure out what was wrong with me. So after several months where I was just so weak, I couldn't go to work, I couldn't go to church, I didn't go anywhere but to the doctor, they finally figured out that I had cancer in my liver. And at this time, I'm devastated. I was told, you have cancer in your liver. I was told we can't do surgery. There's no cure. And at the time I was told that, I was sitting in a wheelchair. So I'm already somewhat feeling like I can't get any lower than this. But the doctor told me that, and he gave no hope. He said, no, we can't do surgery. There's no cure. And when it gets to the end, we'll just be making you comfortable. So when I left the doctor's office, I asked my family, I said, well, did he say what I thought he said? And they said, yes, he did. So I was like, oh my goodness. I went home, I got in the bed, my son, he asked me, well, do you want grandma over here? I said, no, I don't want to talk to anybody. I don't want to see anybody. I got in the bed and I started thinking about death. And it was a really, It was a hard situation because we all know we're gonna die, but when they tell you you're gonna die in a short period of time, it just makes you, it's devastating. It makes your mind go many different ways. So I got in the bed, I started thinking about death, I thought about my family, I thought, you know, what's gonna happen to my family? I thought about my church, and I was the leader of my women's department, and I hadn't had a lot of opportunity to do anything, so I thought about that, and then I even thought about my job. I'm a probation officer for juveniles, and I thought about all the families that I help, and I just got to thinking about, and about 3 days later, I came to myself, I was like, wait a minute, I cannot die. I have places to go, I have people to see, and I have things to do. And at about that same time, God let me know that all you have to do is trust in me. And he gave me the scripture, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not to your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. And at that time, the Lord gave me hope. He gave me hope that I was gonna live, and all I had to do was trust in him. So I began trusting in God. I was sent to UW Hospital in Seattle, where I started chemo immediately first. I started chemo immediately, and the goal was to shrink the tumors. Well, the tumors were not shrinking, and they sent me up to UW Hospital in Seattle. So they reviewed all my information. They took everything before a board of 12 specialists, and they determined that they could do surgery and they could get all the cancer, but they said I wasn't strong enough for surgery. So that was another low blow. So I didn't know what I was gonna do. And the doctor said, well, you can do this. You can get stronger. This is what you need to do. And at that time, I wasn't doing anything but sleeping. I had problems getting just from my bed to my bathroom. And he told me, just get up, just walk down the hall. You can do this. So I started trying to get out of bed, started trying to make myself stronger. And then weeks went on, and he told me that we'll just continue the chemo and give you time to get stronger. So I was trying to get stronger, doing the best I could. While I was going through this process, I had family there, I had my church there, I had people praying for me, people trying to help me, I had the doctors, everybody was just so supportive, but throughout the whole process, I felt like no one understood what I was going through. Not my family, not the doctors, not my friends. I just felt like nobody understood. But I really thank God that through that process, he understood what I was going through. I felt like nobody understood. When I couldn't eat and didn't have any appetite, my family, and it was all in love, they were all trying to help me, they were trying to force me to eat, and I told them, I said, you guys don't get it, I'm not hungry, I don't want to eat. And they were like, well, one more bite, just take one more bite, you can do this. And they put big plates of food in front of me, but I didn't want to eat. And then when the doctor told me, when I was sitting in the wheelchair and he's telling me, you're not strong enough, but you can get stronger, I just looked at him and I thought, you don't get it. You don't understand. You don't know how weak I am. You don't know how I feel. And you don't know that I feel like I can't do this. And you just don't understand. But the doctor, he leaned forward, he looked me straight in the eye and he said, you can do it. So I know that God continued to work through all those people, even though I felt that they didn't understand. God understood, and he still knew how to work through those people. And I thank him that he helped me through that, even though I had people around me, even though I felt like I was in it all alone. God, he took that loneliness from me and let me know that he was there. And not only was he there, but he was working through all these people to support me and be there for me. After several weeks, they continually checked, but they found that the tumors were growing. They were not shrinking. So at one point they decided, well, we need to go ahead and do this surgery. And I went back to see the doctor again, and he said, you do look better, so we will go ahead and do the surgery. And at that time, he still wasn't sure, because he felt that even if they did the surgery, he felt that I would wake up in the ICU. So he was still hesitant to do the surgery, but they did the surgery. And on June 25th, 2015, a little over 2 months after I was told that I was terminal, I went, I had surgery. They took 70% of my liver. They got all the cancer, and God healed my body. They got all the cancer. Afterwards, I had 3 more cycles of chemo. And from that day until this day, I have been having PET scans every 3 months to make sure that the cancer is not back, and the cancer has not returned. And I, to this day, I thank God for his healing power. I thank God for faith. I know that if it hadn't been for God and for my family and for my church, that I would be dead. I would be dead. And I thank God just for bringing me through that, because I didn't know why me. I didn't know why God would allow that to happen to me. But I thank God that through this, I've been able to witness about the healing of God. What the husband can do in a situation like this is be there, be supportive, be understanding, be patient, and recognize that the person is going through something and they may feel abandoned, or they may feel like they're in it all alone. But understanding that if you're just there, if you understand, if you love, if you encourage, that you're doing all that you can do. And then, you know, when the healing comes and the deliverance comes, then you'll recognize that, thank God I did what I needed to do. But God does not just heal from cancer. Everybody doesn't have cancer. People hurt in different ways. And God wants to heal you everywhere you hurt. He wants to heal you anywhere you hurt. You may not be sick with cancer. You may not be sick with any disease, but you might have something going on in your life that's making you emotionally sick, making you mentally sick. God wants to heal your hurts. They're not always physical. They can be emotional. They can be spiritual. They can be mental. But God wants to heal you everywhere you hurt. He healed me of cancer, but that's not the only thing he heals from. He can heal from anything that you're suffering with that is not in accordance to his will. I have been able to let people know that God can heal, even when they say there's no hope, even when they say you're terminal, even when they say you only have months to live and there's nothing they can do. God has the final say. And because God has the final say, I'm still here. I'm healthy. I've had no cancer for over 2.5 years. I am still cancer free. And that is just amazing to be for God to tell you that, and then it happens. I know during the process I prayed and I believed God, but when he did it, I was just amazed. God really did this. I'm still here. I'm still alive. But I thank God for his grace and his mercy. Thank God for his healing power. Thank God just that he still works miracles. And just like he worked miracles for me and my family, God can work a miracle for you. And it doesn't matter what the doctors say. It doesn't matter what anybody says. God has the final say.
No tornadoes, no floods. Thank God for the Pacific Northwest.